acoustics has been with us for a very long time. Those of us who do neurophysiology, who record the activity of brain cells, who try to encode and decode, understand how the brain encodes and decodes the world. So machine learning can demonstrably help us understand the brain through data analysis, through understanding neural dynamics, through understanding signal processing, through artificial neural network models. And in fact, this has been the major focus of my collaborations at IIT Madras, and I'm very pleased to have this collaboration with Hema Murthy and her many brilliant students who work on many different aspects of applying machine learning approaches to understanding neuroscience data that's come from our lab. Srinivas Chakravarti, who builds models of synapses and of reinforcement learning applied to synapses in the context of not only presynaptic, postsynaptic mechanisms, but also non-neuronal mechanisms such as astrocytes and blood vessels. And we talked today about how, we heard today about how one of the great tricks of the brain is to bring power to where computing happens. And blood vessels do that, and astrocytes do that, and my collaboration with Srinivas is about figuring out how that delivery of oxygen and of neuroactive substances can influence the computations by neurons. And our collaboration with Anil Prabhakar is on something else altogether. It's not on analysis of data, but how to get massive amounts of data. Prabhakar is an expert on long wavelength lasers. He builds fiber lasers. And if we are going to use optical tools like we do, like my lab has been very much involved in developing optical tools to record the activity of brain cells, we need ways to go deep in the brain and far in the brain in order to record the activity of hundreds and thousands, if not millions, of neurons. And with Prabhakar's lasers and our optics and our engineering, we are trying to do that. Out of all this, I hope will come some understanding of this very hard question. Can understanding the brain advance machine learning? And I'm going to submit to you that the critical question here is, how do we build an internal model of the world? And that's what cognition is about. And at the root of that problem is understanding how brain circuits encode information and dynamically build and modify internal models. So what is cognition? Cognition refers to mental activity underlying perceiving, understanding, learning, remembering, communicating, and moving, goal-oriented moving. And this is all of the things that hard brains do. But crucial to my thinking is that cognition is much more than machine learning. Cognition is about building internal models of the world. And machine learning is a way to build those models and to update them. So hence, understanding how internal models are built is of the essence in understanding how one day we would build intelligent machines. And I agree with Chris that that is a very valid and even a reachable goal. Whether we should or not, that's a different question and is worthy of discussion. And cognition arises from brain activity and neuronal dynamics that create and update internal representations, and crucially employs internal states such as attention, motivation, desires, and goals. And I do believe that if we understand what these are at an operational level, not at a metaphysical level, but at an operational level, that will bring us closer to understanding how internal models are built. So how might we think about a grand problem like this? After David Marr, who articulated these ideas very early on, most big problems, we need to understand what is the nature of the task. That's what Marr called computation. What are the rules or the procedures by which we might implement the task? And then what is the physical basis for that implementation? And while Marr conceived of a flow, these three levels of analysis as top down, we now know from the extraordinary success of hardware that there's also an arrow up. It's because of this extraordinary memory and computational power that algorithms or even problems that were thought to be very hard to solve are now solvable. So hence, I move the arrows up here. And if we map a computational problem onto the problem of cognition, this is what I'm going to propose to you. that the problem is building internal models. The algorithms involve dynamic neuronal activity and representations, and the hardware is the circuits of the brain. Today, I'll tell you a little bit about all of these and perhaps try to convince you that this is the way, this is a possible way to understand how our brains do what they do. So we have to agree that cognition is the product of the brain. And the brain arises from, the brain is composed in human beings of 80 to 100 billion cells, but they are not organized as soup. They're organized into modular processing systems, the visual cortex and the auditory cortex and the somatosensory and the motor cortex and so forth. And single neuron recordings at very large scale. For decades, people have done single neuron recordings one at a time. And they have given us some clue as to how single cells encode the world. But to ask how brains do cognition, we need large scale recordings from multiple regions simultaneously. Single neurons at a time, at the mesoscopic scale. I do believe that while functional MRI, in which each pixel has within it hundreds of thousands of neurons, while it's useful for telling us localization of function, it is not very useful for telling us how computations are carried out at the level of single neurons and the networks that they engage. So I do emphasize, as a bias in my head, the mesoscopic scale of understanding, where not at the level of a synapse and not at the level of a fMRI pixel, but at the level of a single neuron and the activity that it encodes via its electrical spikes, doing large-scale recording across multiple systems is crucial for understanding brain functions underlying cognition. And of course, every neuron in the brain differs from any cell anywhere in the body by virtue of two features. First, it's at an excitable membrane, and that excitable membrane, via Hodgkin and Huxley and many, 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 many scientists who have discovered the ion channels. These are little proteins by which a voltage gradient, by which ionic gradients are maintained of sodium and potassium, leading to action potentials. There is no information in the height of the action potential. All the information is in the interval between action potentials. So neurons fire action potentials, and that's the currency of the brain. And neurons speak to other neurons at synapses. The average neuron makes 10,000 synapses onto hundreds of other neurons. So these two features of single neurons talking to other neurons via synapses makes networks. And these networks are the engine of the brain. So just to bring you to speed with one slide, because I feel I started late, so I should talk fast. What is an internal representation and why is it useful? Here are four pictures, self-portraits made by a German artist named Anton Reiterscheid. And when Reiterscheid was 68 years old, he had a stroke. He had a stroke in one part of his brain, and he looks at a mirror and he draws these four self-portraits. A trained neurologist will tell you at one glance from looking at these pictures where his stroke was. I will tell you where it is. It is in the right parietal cortex. It's right here. How do I know? Reiterscheid looks at a mirror and he draws one eye, half a nose, and half a mouth. The left side of his face is completely blank. There is nothing wrong with his eyes. There is nothing wrong with his ability to draw. There is something profoundly wrong in his ability to integrate the external world, and particularly the side opposite his stroke. It's called left spatial neglect. It's a well-known phenomenon. Then 3 months later, he draws another portrait, and the left side of his face still has poverty. And then Reiterscheid realizes there is something wrong, and he turns away. And this is another remarkable feature of the human brain, is to come. And then 3 more months and Reiterscheid was lucky. The rest of the brain, a stroke happens when a part of the brain is devoid of oxygen because there is a blood clot usually, or a hemorrhage such that a blood vessel is either clogged or breaks. So neurons live for only a few minutes without oxygen. They are extremely energy demanding, though little bit of energy. And so the other neurons are sometimes, if you're lucky, able to take over, and if you practice a lot. What this tells us is that internal representations of the world, including of his own face, formed from specific networks, in this case, a network in which the parietal cortex is a crucial node. And this network can be dynamically reorganized, and spatial attention, because there is nothing wrong with his vision otherwise, but he does not attend to half of objects in the world. This is not an egocentric ignoring. It is an object-centric ignoring. It's not as if he turns his head and looks at his face, he will now see his whole face. No. He refers the completeness of an image to the object. So the left side of every object is ignored. This is a very high-level function. And so spatial, and it is ignored because it is not attended to. So spatial attention is fundamental for an internal representation of space. I'll tell you two experiments today from my lab about how internal representations are created in the brain. And in the first one, I'll focus on the internal state of attention. How does attention mediate cortical representations? And in the second one, very briefly, I'll talk most about that. In the second one, I'll talk very briefly about another internal state, memory, and how that could be created in cortical circuits. And the goal is to see how these ideas could be used to understand cognition via internal representations. And at the very end, we'll come back from this trench of experimental neuroscience and reflect on how this might inform machine learning. So most of the work I'll tell you have been performed by two extremely talented people. Michael Gord, who was a postdoc in my lab for several years, now has his own lab at UC Santa Barbara, and Gerald Foe, who's finishing his PhD. Just to emphasize the point of how important the parietal cortex is, because that's one area that I'll be talking about. In a human being, if you have a lesion of this right parietal cortex due to a stroke, or if you hit your head, unfortunately, and you look at the world, you ask a patient to draw pictures, that patient will draw only half a clock face, or only half of a house, or only half of a flower. And this has nothing to do with their ability to draw or to see, but to integrate information from the world and create a model of the world. Even seeing relies on a model of the world. And so, and of course, attention filters and focuses information from the world. It's a key component of cognition, and the parietal cortex is a crucial node for attention. And just to emphasize how important attention is as a top-down phenomena, in addition to the bottom-up component of seeing. Vision starts with the eyes, but is really created in the brain. And over the last 50 years since Hubel and Wiesel and many, 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 many people, we have some significant understanding of how the multiple areas of visual pathways, at least in the ventral pathway, lead to object recognition. And in fact, one of the most successful models of applying machine learning and artificial neural network multi-layer models has been through my colleague Jim DiCarlo and others, to show that one can plausibly interpret the responses of different cortical areas as responses in multiple hidden layers of a multi-layer network that leads to object recognition at the one end from pixels of light at the beginning. That's the problem of object recognition. But there are other areas in the brain that mediate internal states. Object recognition can be solved as a purely bottom-up problem. But attention, what you choose to see, what is it that you do see, those are aspects of internal states, and those involve other areas, in particular the parietal cortex and the frontal cortex. We study mice, and you might ask, what is it that mice can do when it comes to higher brain functions? Well, the mouse brain is teeny tiny compared to the human brain, and it is actually 1,000 the volume of a human brain. So that's the mouse brain, that's a human brain. And if you were to take a mouse brain, all these colored regions are the sensory areas of the brain. For example, the sense of touch is in red, and the visual area is in blue, and the auditory area is in green. So if you blow up the mouse brain to the size of a human brain, what you see is that in the human brain, there is a lot more white areas, which are the higher areas that are non-sensory. The mouse brain has much less white, but it has some. And the parts that are there have homologies to critical parts of the human brain. Hence, it makes sense to study the mouse brain. And of course, we can use very advanced genetic and optical tools to study thousands, hundreds of thousands, and I submit to you in 5 years, millions of neurons simultaneously using advanced tools that can allow us windows into cognition. So that's what we do. And what do we do with mice? Well, we can train them. We can train them like circus trainers train, you know, dogs and lions. We can train them to do interesting tasks. We can train them to do a perceptual decision task. We do this task all the time. For example, if you are at a traffic light, it's a little bit hazy, there is uncertain information, yet we make decisions under uncertainty. From sensory evidence, we decide, should we stop, should we go, and then we decide to go. So then we can take mice and we can train them on a go, no-go task, because that's what essentially this is. This is called the go, no-go task. You either go or you don't go. It's a very simple task, but it has within it all of the richness of cognition. So here's a mouse, and here's the lick spout, and here's a screen. And we train the mouse to lick when it sees a target and to not lick when it sees a different target. And this target is shown for a couple of seconds, and then the lick spout comes forward, and the mouse should lick when it sees this and not lick, withhold licking when it sees this. And in order to train the mouse, you have to both reward it with chocolate-flavored water or punish it with quinine-flavored water. And the mouse learns within a week or two that it should lick when it sees this and withhold licking when it sees this. And so here's the 2x2 matrix that when it sees this, it should lick. When it sees this, it should not lick. But the mouse, of course, makes mistakes, and there are two kinds of mistakes. It licks when it shouldn't. That's a type 1 error. It's called a false alarm. And it doesn't lick when it should. That's called a miss. I'll show you briefly what it is and how this works. And I hope this works for me. All right. So here's the mouse, and here's the target stimulus, and the mouse licks. I hope you saw that. Now you'll see a non-target stimulus. Non-target stimulus. The mouse does not lick. And let's see what Gerald gave me. Okay, that's a target stimulus, and the mouse licks. Okay, so we can play these games with this mouse. And we can define the behavior very quantitatively using signal detection theory by plotting the distribution, essentially, of the success rate and the error rate, and the difference between the two distributions in units of standard deviation is the D prime. And this is a well-known psychological metric for defining performance. So these mice have reasonably high D primes, and you can see that here. And then we do one trick. We show the mouse the stimulus, but we do not bring forward the spout over a set of trials. So the mouse knows when there is no spout, these guys are playing games with me. I'm not going to get a reward, so the mouse switches off. That's the non-engaged or the passive condition versus the engaged condition where the mouse is doing all of this and is getting a reward. Not only is the mouse not licking, but we know that the mouse is not paying attention because we can monitor the mouse's eye. And the eye pupil is a very sensitive indicator of attention. When we are attending, the pupils dilate when there is low levels of light. That's a bottom-up reason for more light to come in. But the pupils dilate under the influence of neurotransmitters such as norepinephrine and acetylcholine. And that's a high-level attention-based mechanism that we can read out in the pupil. And we can read out in the pupil whether the mouse is attending. And through all of this, we can see that when the mouse is engaged, it licks, there is a certain success, correct licks, incorrect licks, the difference gives the D prime, and when there is passive, the mouse cannot lick, so the difference is zero. So there is no lick fraction. So that's what this means. I hope everybody is with me. I'm taking a little bit of trouble to explain this to you, because I know you don't think about these things all the time. But this is the nature of tasks that the field can do, and then we can apply electrophysiology, and we do electrophysiology with light. Unlike Hubel and Wiesel, who won a Nobel Prize, or even the Mosers, who won a Nobel Prize recently for their work on place fields in the hippocampus, who put electrodes in the brain and recorded cell by cell, we now do electrophysiology at a large scale. We we can record the activity of hundreds or thousands of neurons using genetically encoded calcium indicators that change their fluorescence as a result of spike activity. And that change in calcium fluorescence can be imaged using a laser that can be targeted into the brain. You have to, of course, remove the skull and put a window on the brain. So it works for small brains. And so we would like to record, and we do, from multiple areas simultaneously. In this experiment, we recorded from these two areas, the parietal cortex that I've already told you a lot about, and the primary visual cortex, because we want to show what happens as information goes from the visual to the parietal cortex in order to carry out an attention-based transformation. Okay? And so this is what these recordings look like. I hope I can see it. Where is my... Okay, so we have a laser that's moving rapidly across the brain, and each blink is a spike, and I've slowed everything down. But you can see these 50 or so neurons in this very small fraction of brain tissue, 100 microns by 100 microns, neurons that are spiking away. And that's what these blinks mean. We are now building in our lab methods for recording from 100,000 to a million neurons simultaneously using each of these regions that I showed you. We can split up a laser beam using a diffractive element into 64 or even 128 by 128 arrays, and thereby scan 64 individual sections, each of which are a few hundred microns by a few hundred microns. And by using very long wavelength laser light, this is where Anil Prabhakar is helping us, we can go deep in the brain rather than just superficially. And combining wide field imaging with deep tissue imaging, we think we can image up to a million neurons, which is still only 1/50th of a mouse's brain. A mouse has about 30 to 50 million neurons, but is much more than one, and quite a bit more than 100 to 1,000. Each point is one neuron. Each blip here, or each blip here, this is one neuron. One neuron, 10 microns wide.
Yeah,
a human hair is 80 microns, so it's 1/8 the width of a human hair.
Sorry, yeah, here.
Yeah.
This is just the neurons on one section on one plane?
One plane.
So
we go in multiple planes using an objective lens that we can, using a piezoelectric driver or a charge-coupled objective where we can change the focal length because it has this fluid in it.
So can you control the orientation of the planes? Or
No, that's much harder, but we can control the orientation at one shot by having a nose piece that can tilt the whole objective. But we cannot image at the same time across different planes, and that remains a huge problem, but we can solve that by imaging in depth. So using very long wavelength, high-powered laser, we can image now up to 2 millimeters in depth. Yes. Yes, we are. We are missing very high-frequency spikes because the calcium signal is a few hundred milliseconds. It depends on your sensor. Now we use sensors in which each spike is transformed into a calcium signal that is a couple of hundred milliseconds wide, or at least 100 milliseconds wide. So if spikes come at faster rates than that, then they get transformed into the amplitude of the signal. And in fact, in a very wonderful project with Hema and her students, Jill Sebastian and others, we are figuring out algorithms to deconvolve the calcium signal to recover the underlying electrical spike rate. In fact, that is a very beautiful example of machine learning approaches to a small but very important problem.
And this question is, how
100% with the sensor. And we ourselves have recorded. Oh, absolutely. We can do intracellular recording from a neuron and do two-photon imaging. And every calcium spike has a sodium spike. It may have more than one sodium spike. That's the challenge, and that gets transformed into amplitude. Every sodium spike has a calcium spike. Yeah. Okay, so the goal is to record from the visual cortex and the parietal cortex in this mouse that is doing this go, no-go task, right? And under some, in some conditions there is a reward, and in some conditions there is no reward in some block of trials. And the first point I'll make is, what happens when there is no reward, so that the mouse's brain has switched off, so the mouse is not paying attention. And the parietal cortex, but not V1, not the primary visual cortex responses, are strongly dependent on attention. Here is a visual cortex neuron. It sees a target stimulus. So V1 neurons respond to either one orientation or another. This neuron responds to horizontal orientations. It responds, then it sees the vertical, no response, it sees the horizontal, it responds, and so forth. And you remove the lid spout, and there's almost no change in the primary visual cortex neuron's responses, because it is a passive bottom-up driver. Here is the parietal cortex. It's a higher level area. It gets input not only from V1, but from many other areas. And we believe it is strongly engaged in attentional modulation and even in crafting attention. Remember Anton Rederscheid. So when the mouse is given reward, this neuron responds to the rewarded target. But when the spout is removed, this mouse's response is zero. The same neurons response is zero. So in visual cortex, in the primary visual cortex, there is no difference in the engaged and the passive conditions, or in the attending versus non-attending, whereas in the parietal cortex, in the non-attending condition, the response is absolutely wiped out, and that's what you see here. And I remind you that the visual stimulus is identical during engaged and passive trials. It's only the internal state of attention that is different. So it is a remarkable top-down crafting of a cognitive construct in this brain region, okay? During engaged trial, the mouse is not only attending, but it has to generate the motor plan that will make the parietal cortex drive the motor cortex, which will drive the licking behavior. And you saw that the mouse licks like crazy when it can. So in the HIT trials, 2 seconds of stimulus, and then the spout comes forward and the mouse licks, that is this remarkable phenomena of a sequence. Different neurons fire one after the other in order to generate a sequential dynamics of activity. It is not necessarily predicted from a very simple network model of anything. But this doesn't happen in a correct reject, which is, of course, the vertical stimulus. The mouse should not lick, and responses, there are no responses. And so if you look at 174 neurons, performing, and the mouse is performing all of these things one after the other. It gets a HIT trial. Horizontal bars, lick. Then a little break. Then a vertical bar, and the mouse licks. It's a false alarm. But there is the beginning of a sequence, but then everything disappears. So why is there an error? Because the mouse's brain makes an error or starts to make an error, but then gives up. It knows that I'm getting punished with the quinine. Then here's a correct reject. Here is a vertical stimulus. The mouse does not lick. There is no activity. Another false alarm. Here's two hits. Horizontal stimuli, and the mouse licks. And here's a sequence. Horizontal stimulus, the mouse licks. Here's a sequence. So the sequence is a combination of an internal code for licking and the reinforcement of that code by the reward. How does the mouse's brain generate the decision to lick? Here's a little bit of how we use machine learning to understand this. We can do a time-resolved decoding analysis, distinguishing stationary and dynamic coding. So here is a set of neurons that are active in the parietal cortex when the mouse licks. Here's another set of neurons when the mouse does not lick, when it shouldn't lick. That's a correct reject. So we build a decoder based on one time bin, and we look at another time bin. So we use half of our data to create a decoder. And then we test with the other half of the data, and we test at either the same time bin at which we have made the training that we have built the decoder, or we test at later time bins. And of course, the way we test is to use any algorithm that will compare the activity pattern with the test pattern. And the activity pattern could be compared with, say, a support vector machine or any other kind of, you know, metric using some Mahalanobis distance or any other kind of distance metric. So here's the idea. If the same pattern of neurons is carrying out the decoding as the mouse proceeds through the task, then if you build a decoder here, it should work here and here and here. But if the pattern of neurons is different, then the decoder will only work for a short while, but then you will have to build another decoder for the next short while and another decoder for the next short while. Okay? That's the intuition. And indeed, what we find is that in the parietal cortex, if you build a decoder at one time point and you apply it at that time point, it works. You build it here, it works. If you build it here, it works. It works wonderfully. So black is train and test a different decoder at each time step. But then you build a decoder here and you apply it for all of this data and it works up to a while and then it crashes. And this is it. And it works for up to a second or so and then it crashes. And then here's another decoder built here, and then it crashes, and another, and so forth. So these colored lines are you train on a single time window and test on all other time windows, and it doesn't work very well. In contrast, in the visual cortex, the coding is much more static. It's the same pattern of neurons that are responsive to the lick stimulus that hold that value, that neuronal population is held throughout the stimulus and the reward. So there is a dynamic coding of choice occurs in posterior parietal cortex because the network of neurons is being dynamically reorganized as the mouse proceeds through the task and is carrying out his decision as opposed to visual cortex. Then what Gerald did is that he switched the contingencies. So it's equivalent to saying now this is a go and this is a stop. It actually makes us very uncomfortable. Human beings, this has been known as the McGurk effect or whatever. If I were to make you write the word yellow, but with a red pen, you would feel nauseous for a while and then you will recover. Okay, so, but mice can learn this switch and they learn to do the switch now very effectively with the same deep rhyme that they used to do the earlier task, but now switched. So now this is go. It used to be go, this is now no go. This used to be no go, this is now go. What happens to the responses? In the visual cortex, nothing happens to the responses. This was the go stimulus, and now this has become no go, so it has, so neurons respond to either horizontals or verticals, and they continue to do that. But in the parietal cortex, something remarkable happens. A neuron that used to respond to the horizontal stimulus now begins to respond to the vertical stimulus. So these neurons are signaling not only engagement, but they are providing the motor plan that now lick. So they are so-called, you know, if one is fancy, one would call them decision neurons, or one can call them the sensory motor transformation neurons. But PPC neurons switch their selectivity so that it's the same, and we know it's the same neuron. That's the beauty of optical methods of recording. Over weeks, we can record the same neurons over and over and over again because we have a window on the brain. This is a awake behaving mouse. We can go back, we can pick out the identical neuron, and we can ask, what is this neuron doing today under today's conditions as opposed to a week ago under a week ago's conditions? And that's what they're doing. So this tells you it's the very same neurons. And these neurons switch their preference, whereas the V1 neurons never do. And this we can see 1 second at sushi. And so this is what this says, that the population selectivity switches dramatically. That in the original, these used to be the fraction of go neurons. And that's another remarkable aspect of plasticity and of dynamic decision making. That when you train a mouse, 90% of neurons that you record are now geared to this task. And when you switch the contingency now, 80% to 90% of neurons are now geared to that task. So these are task dependent. These are stimulus dependent. And so this says that V1 neurons reflect the sensory stimulus, The parietal neurons respond to the rewarded stimulus and convey a decision and motor plan. And linking it up with attention, what does this have to do with attention? We believe everything, because what is attention? Attention drives action selection. That is why we believe that the parietal cortex is so attention selective. Atsushi. About a week. Time goes off the behavior during the learn during the reversal. As opposed to the original learning, it's faster. The reversal is faster. Oh, yes. Identical. Absolutely, identical. Okay. And then, of course, new sequences form with the reversal. This is consistent with the idea that a decision is a set of neurons and their activity patterns. Okay, so attention underlies cognition and has widespread effects. Internal states are crucially mediated by neurotransmitter systems. And this has been written about, and Partha also alluded to this. There are complex interconnections, not only between brain regions. I've told you a little bit about these two brain regions, but there are these neurotransmitter systems, such as for acetylcholine, such as for dopamine, and such as for norepinephrine, that themselves get multiple inputs from multiple brain regions. That's why we want to record the entire brain in order to see how not only the cortical processing regions, but the modulatory regions interface with the cortex. So while attention affects the parietal cortex, we believe that it's actually the neurotransmitter systems that are the driver of attention. And this is there is a long history to that. But one thing that attention does is that it also enhances representations. So in monkeys, this has been known for a while, and in our mice, we can see that at a glance. If you recall from 800 neurons in the primary visual cortex, when the mouse is not attending, neurons are much more synchronized than when the mouse is attending. And we can do the statistics of noise correlations, and we can show that there is much more reduced correlations, interneuronal correlations, pairwise correlation, Pearson's correlation, when the mouse is attending, versus when the mouse is not attending. So neurons are firing more. This is over short time periods, okay? And there is a whole literature on how does synchrony work versus how does decorrelation work, and I can discuss that later. So we believe that acetylcholine inputs from the basal forebrain to the visual cortex are crucial for attention. And again, there is a literature on that. And what Nayan and Hiroki did was to ask how. This takes us into circuits, and I don't know how much time I have, but I'll just go through it very briefly, just give you a flavor before I go on to the last part of my talk. So while I've talked about dynamics, underlying the dynamics are circuits of excitatory and inhibitory neuron that are the engine of those dynamics. And the field of circuits has exploded due to the combination of both optical tools for recording and optogenetics, which is optical ways of manipulating single neurons or single subtypes of neurons. We now know that an average pyramidal neuron in the visual cortex gets inputs that look somewhat like this. There is bottom-up inputs to the pyramidal neuron, but there is one kind of inhibitory neuron called the parvalbumin neuron that provides feed-forward inhibition. There's another kind of inhibitory neuron called somatostatin neuron that provides feedback inhibition. And there is a third kind of neuron called the vasoactive intestinal peptide neuron. These are big words. They refer to what kind of substances these neurons contain. And they in turn inhibit these other neuron types. So this is not, we believe, an accident where there are 500 kinds of neurons that could all be interchanged one with another. Nature has gone to great trouble to build inhibition and then inhibition of inhibition. And we think that has consequences. And I'll show you one of those consequences. So somatostatin and parvalbumin neurons are the major cell types that target pyramidal neurons. And that's what is shown here. And we have asked, what is the effect of acetylcholine on this input comes to inhibit and disinhibit this bottom-up input and thereby separate, smears out in time, the activity of neurons. I'll show you very briefly how these experiments are done, just so that you know how I know what I know. So we can take genetically engineered strains of mice. They are called PV Cree or somatostatin Cree mice, and we can put in a virus that contains the channel rhodopsin gene, which inserts itself into these neurons because of the way that this virus and this construct is made. And so it's only in the PV neurons do we express this molecule called channel rhodopsin. What is channel rhodopsin? It's the same molecule that's in your eye and mine. It takes light and converts it into electrical potentials. Channel rhodopsin is found in algae that live in seabeds, and it takes light and it makes action potentials, sodium spikes. We know it does that because we can record from these spikes and we can shine light on the brain, and we can see spikes happening from just the PV neurons or just the somatostatin neurons. And why do we want to do that? It's because we want to show a mouse visual stimuli and make it process visual information and then add a teeny tiny bit of inhibition to manipulate the circuit and while at the same time record the activity of hundreds of neurons in order to see what effect does this additional teeny tiny bit of inhibition have. And that's how we know what this cell type does or what that cell type does. And to make a long story very short, I can show you a little bit of what this looks like. Here are 80 neurons in a piece of a mouse brain, about 100 microns by 100 microns. They are blinking away as the mouse is looking at this grating. And then on this one neuron in the middle, I hope you can see that, for a short period of time, for half a second, we shine blue light on this one neuron that is a paralbumin neuron that is expressing channel rhodopsin. So we add a little bit of inhibition through this one neuron, and we can image the effect on all the other neurons. And what this tells us is that paralbumin neurons divide responses, whereas somatostatin neurons subtract responses and alter selectivity. But then, that's what these connections are about. But then there is this connection, and to understand this entire circuit, one can take a mouse in which this acetylcholine can be released in the brain by blue light. And when we do that, we see a desynchronization. This has been known for a long time. This is what happens when we wake up, that acetylcholine floods our brain and our EEG gets desynchronized. And the EEG gets desynchronized because our neurons are decorrelated. And we can show that there is much more power in the high frequency in the EEG compared to the low frequency once you release acetylcholine, and the single neurons are more decorrelated when they are responding to visual stimuli. We can play a trick now to deconstruct this circuit. In the somatostatin, I'm just showing you one little piece of data. In the somatostatin neuron, we express not channel rhodopsin, which makes a cell fire, but another molecule called ARCH rhodopsin, which if you shine green light, hyperpolarizes the cell. So here's a slice of the visual cortex. We are recording from a somatostatin neuron, okay? And we put a little bit of acetylcholine, one drop, and this somatostatin neuron fires like crazy. It has receptors for acetylcholine. Then we shine green light on this slice, and that effect of that drop of acetylcholine is zero because we have hyperpolarized this somatostatin neuron. We take a paralbumin neuron and we record from this, and you put a little bit of acetylcholine in the bath, this neuron hyperpolarizes, arguing that it is getting some kind of inhibition. And you shine green light to shut down this neuron, and the hyperpolarization goes away, arguing that the only way this neuron is being affected by acetylcholine is through this circuit. This is how we deconstruct circuits. Similarly, you record from this neuron and you put acetylcholine and you get a IPSP, EPSP, or IPSC, EPSC, and you shine green light to shut down this neuron, thereby shutting off this pathway, and that activity goes away. And finally, you can ask in a living mouse, we can create this decorrelation and desynchronization by shining blue light in this mouse in which channel rhodopsin is driving acetylcholine. And then on top of that, there is the somatostatin neuron is expressing this molecule which can be activated by green light. So it's playing with lights, but it's a remarkable level of specificity in the context of dissecting circuits. And by shining green light, we can shut down the effect of the release of acetylcholine by removing the desynchronization and the decorrelation. So this is what this shows, that the amplitude in the high frequency end goes back down when you have blue plus green light compared to blue light alone. So release of acetylcholine leads to desynchronization and decorrelation, but that acetylcholine effect is remarkably mediated through this one cell type. And that gives you a little bit of idea of how attention works. And why is this interesting? Why is decorrelation interesting? It's because suppose you have two neurons. You know, we have built a model. I'm not going to tell you the model in great detail. We don't have time. If you have two neurons, and one neuron is firing five spikes, and here's another neuron that this neuron is firing five spikes, okay? Somebody who's looking at these two neurons, if these neurons are firing at exactly the same time, they are highly correlated. They will not be able to distinguish. There is no more information in this second neuron. There is a lot of information if these two neurons are connecting to some other neuron. These two neurons will make that neuron fire a lot. But the information representation in this set of neurons is reduced when there is high synchrony. But if the second neuron fires is jittered, then there is much more information in this second neuron. You can reduce the correlations by editing spikes. You can remove spikes. And that too will reduce the correlation between the two neurons, but you have reduced the spike rate. That is not a good thing. In the limit, if you make this neuron completely silent, then it's no use having that neuron. So the challenge for the brain is to decorrelate without changing the mean rate. And that's what an inhibitionary disinhibitory circuit does. Okay? So this is one mechanism by which attention influences parietal responses and decorrelates V1 responses via acetylcholine that acts on inhibitory disinhibitory circuits. Very quickly, we can go back to our original task, go, no go, and add a delay. Why do we want to add a delay? It's because we want to separate the visual from the motor components. And it lets us ask, where is memory represented? Because when the animal licks, it has to remember what it saw. And we can add delays of 3 times the length of each stimulus, such as 6 seconds of delay, which is a lifetime for a mouse. So that's a delay. 6 seconds. And then the spout comes forward and the mouse licks. Okay. If you were to give me a phone number and ask me 6 seconds later, what is that phone number? I'm not sure I'll remember. But mice do. And so now we are recording from V1, parietal, and motor cortex because we have a hypothesis that in such tasks, it is the farthest reach of a network that holds the critical elements of the task. It is counter to potentially ideas about artificial neural networks. And indeed, we find that in this kind of task, which we are recording from the visual cortex, the parietal cortex, and the motor cortex, which is way in the front of the animal. It is the motor cortex responses. Here are 321 neurons that have the most response during the delay. Not the visual, which we didn't expect, and not even the parietal, which we did expect, but the motor cortex responses. And there are 2 kinds of neurons. A neuron that responds to the stimulus and holds the delay, and another kind of neuron that responds to the motor lick. Okay. And we can analyze this. So during the delay period, again, as an internal state, there is nothing in front of the animal. I showed it very quickly, but there was a stimulus. It went away. There's a blank screen, but the brain is firing away. And that is what is an internal state underlying the cognitive construct of short-term memory. And so that's where, and that internal state is held in the motor cortex. You can see that here. These are all multiple. These are 100,000. Oh, yes, there are. Very much fewer. Much fewer.
approach to categories.
Absolutely correct. That's why the next phase in our field is to look at subcategories and where do they project to and so forth, which involves much more refined experiments that we are carrying out. So one can ask, one can do a dimension reduction analysis and ask, how many dimensions are there in this set of neurons? Anand. Yeah, yeah. I need to finish. Yeah. Totally. Not totally, but quite a bit. Long-term memory is crafted in the hippocampus, but then shipped out to the cortex. Okay, because so short-term and long-term memory, things that have valence, things, memory for events, facts, things, go through the hippocampus. Even this may be going through the hippocampus, but we don't understand in what way, or at least we haven't studied it. How might we interpret? Here's one more very quick example, and then I'll finish. So if you have two neurons, they're firing, or three neurons, their conjoint firing rate through the space of firing gives you an idea of what these two neurons are encoding, right? If you have 100 neurons, you have 100 dimensions, but you can do a PCA, and you can ask, how is most of the variance captured? And we have done that, and so very quickly in the visual cortex, there are, through the stimulus and delay and response, all of the activity is in either horizontal or vertical stimulus sensitive neurons. These are sensory neurons. And by the time that the delay happens, neurons come back to the origin. There is no attractor dynamics here. In the motor cortex, though, we see these recurrent network-dependent dynamics where one set of neurons, stimulus-dependent, and hangs out in the basin of the memory, and then another set of neurons fires and gives the response. So this is fairly standard principal components analysis. But just as an example for the students here as to how one might use dimension reduction analysis, all of these 371 neurons that we recorded, they essentially are carrying out two functions. Encode the stimulus and the delay or fire. Why are there 370, or for that matter in motor cortex, probably a couple of million neurons? Because this is not the only task that the mouse does. The mouse does many things, and this is a very humble go-no-go task. It makes sense, it'll have only two principal components.
So
We have. And that's a much, much, much more complex question. Again, why does the mouse make errors? It's because its motor cortex or its parietal cortex even makes errors. And of course, we know that behavioral tasks engage a distributed hierarchy of areas. There are all these areas in the human, in the primate brain. Even in the mouse brain, there are these seven areas that intervene between V1 and motor cortex. But what these results tell us, that when you have this kind of reinforcement learning, there is a very rapid dynamic routing of information from the primary visual directly to the motor cortex, because there is a signature of the visual stimulus and of its delay in the motor cortex, not in the parietal, not in other intermediate regions. And this is another example of how the brain takes its circuits and does what it does. Can machine learning help us understand the brain? Of course, but our work has focused on dynamics. We have shown that parietal responses show dynamic coding during decisions and choice. V1 responses show dynamic decorrelation during attention, and we have revealed a circuit for it. And we think that there are such circuits that underlie each of these critical functions of the brain. And motor cortex responses show dynamic routing and attractor dynamics. And of course, our work has emphasized the continuous unsupervised or supervised learning mechanisms, et cetera, using both dimension reduction, we have used linear regression. But this is all the stuff of statistics, and there's no question that we need all of this to analyze the data that we are generating. In any given day, my lab generates 100 to 200 gigabytes of data. So we need all the help we can get. And this is for any given mouse. That is maybe 2 months of recording, maybe 3 months of recording, 60, 90, 100 days of recording, each with 100 to 200 gigabytes of data from hundreds, thousands of neurons. If you get up to a million neurons, that is 100 times more. Finally, how can machine, how can understanding the brain advance machine learning, machine intelligence? I don't know. Here is something that I got from the net on a fairly complete chart of neural networks. And they don't look too much like brain networks to me. But that's maybe one reason why they have been successful. So one should be aware, and I say this as a neuroscientist, of the fallacy of biological complexity. We did not understand flight by studying the structure of feathers. We understood flight by understanding what is it that birds really do, that to offset weight, they have to generate lift, and to offset drag, they have to generate thrust. And we fly in many different ways, and we fly much better in some ways, except that we cannot land on a tree branch, etc. So, with the circuits that underlie the dynamics, I submit we create internal models of the world. And such circuits need to be understood, and such dynamics need to be understood, and of course the internal models need to be very much more understood. And I'm going to end with a quote from Patricia Churchland and Terry Sanowski in a paper, in a little reflective article that they wrote. The neuroscience is both theory and data poor, and we need to understand both. So I'm going to stop there, and I'm going to acknowledge the various people in my lab who used to be in my lab, my collaborators at IIT Madras, who will speak themselves, Hema and Srinivas. So I haven't spoken about their work, but I did mention Anil's work, and we have a lot of funding. Sources, not a lot of funding, a lot of funding. Sources, each with a little bit of money. Thank you.
Thank you, Mringaka, for a very wonderful talk. I enjoyed it very much. When we record from macaques, of course, with a more primitive technique of recording of single units that you do, not the multiple electrodes, or with a photon imaging.
I didn't say primitive, I said early.
But one thing we have found is that very similar to what you find in parietal cortex, you find neurons which are modulated by attention. But in V1 also, under some conditions you do, for example, when you have only a simple stimulus, one stimulus, you don't find it. But when you have a clutter, when you need the finer grain representation of V1, you do find very significant modulation for attention. Is it possible to have a similar paradigm in the mouse, or is it too challenging for the mouse?
A mouse can't do very complex behavior, at least artificial behaviors. A mouse in its own niche, I'm sure, has just as much complexity as any organism in its niche. But the challenge for us is to find interesting behaviors that the mouse can do from which we can derive interesting lessons. So the whole field of electrophysiology in awake behaving animals has progressed in a way that has emphasized artificial behaviors. What you do, what I do, you know, a mouse has no reason to have evolved to look at horizontal versus vertical grating and make any sense of them, but we have forced it to. So it's possible that with the right kind of task, a mouse would exhibit very significant modulations in very different ways that in primates we already know. But I would be a little hesitant to make that conclusion very strongly. A mouse's brain is not a monkey or a human brain in miniature. Okay, and so a mouse's brain, and maybe Atsushi can weigh in on this, has evolved for its niche. These niches are different, and of course there is much more, many more brain regions, much more complexity, not only many more neurons, so those do add content. This is a long answer to saying, I don't know. The imaging that I have shown you is up to 500 microns. The cerebral cortex of a mouse is about 800 microns. So this goes down, if you know, in terms of cortical layers, the cortex has 6 layers, this goes down to the bottom of layer 4. But now we can image using 3 photon microscopy down to 2 millimeters, which goes from the surface of the brain to the hippocampus, which is one of the subcortical structures. So there's the cortex, there is the white matter, there's the hippocampus, there's the thalamus, there's the basal ganglia from the back to the front. and we can image the top of those. But there's still work in progress. I intermix many different kinds of data, but most of the data I talked about is from imaging at least 3 or 4 different planes, each separated by 100 microns or 50 microns. So there are different neurons. And of course, to meet Nyquist rate, all of this has to happen. You know, a neuron is firing, let's say at 10 hertz or let's say at 100 hertz. That means you have to sample each neuron at twice that rate. That means that, let's say a neuron is firing at 10 hertz, you have to sample at 20 hertz, which means every 50 milliseconds, you have to come and sample a neuron. And that means all of these different depths have to be gone through, and you have to hit a neuron again 50 milliseconds later with your laser beam.